Joining me this morning is Angela Bauer, who is the lead of the Facilities Operations and Maintenance Group in the Mission Operations Directorate. Angela, when you tell somebody what it is that you do for a living, how do you explain what that job is?
Well, if that person doesn't work here at NASA, the way I explain it is that everything that you see when you look at this room on television is something that my group controls. So we control or we take care of things as mundane as the carpet and the paint color on the walls, but we also take care of the very important things such as the workstations and the consoles that the flight controllers sit at. We control the data that flows here from the spacecraft through a ground station to here. We take care of the processing that happens to that data. We make sure that that data gets down to the flight controllers so that they can see it and view it and look for troubleshooting and do their jobs.
And your work is not restricted to just this room in this building.
No, we take care of this entire building, which includes this room. We actually right now have 4 flight control rooms. So we have this room. We still have the white flight control room, which was used for the shuttle. And now it is sitting waiting for the next opportunity, which will be actually the Orion Exploration Flight 1, which will happen in 2014. We're going to use that room. We also have a blue flight control room and a red flight control room. Those are mainly used for tests and simulations right now. And in addition to that, we also have server rooms throughout the building. We have rooms where the data comes in. We have a lot of equipment that handles all of the voice, all of the key sets and headsets that the flight controllers use to communicate back and forth. We also have a lot of equipment that does the video, such as the video you're watching right now, the video that you can see on the screens behind us.
On a day-to-day basis, on a routine basis, what sort of support are your folks called upon to provide?
Oh, we do everything. Daily, we take care of a lot of things called anomalies that the flight controllers and other people report.
They don't sound good.
No, but sometimes they're not bad. sometimes an anomaly is that a workstation monitor isn't working or a unit that we use to communicate for the voice isn't working, and those are pretty easy to fix. Sometimes they're a little bit more complicated when you have a flight controller attempt to send a command and the command doesn't leave the building. Then that takes a lot more troubleshooting to go figure out. You've got to go get into the computer code and start to find out what happened and what went wrong.
Those sorts of things, are those routine, those kind of problems?
Problems with the command system are not very routine.
No.
The command system has been in place for it was initiated about 15 years ago, so our homegrown command system is actually pretty robust, and we don't have a lot of problems with it these days.
In a dynamic environment like that, where you've got a spaceship in orbit with a crew, these kind of things, there must be some more unusual calls for support that your folks get. Can you give us a couple of examples of the non-routine things that happen?
Well, On a large scale, I'd say probably some of the most unusual requests we've gotten in the past couple of years have had to do with the way that technology has changed so much. And so we've had to figure out ways that we could have the astronauts do things such as post to Twitter and surf the internet and get their email while they're up on orbit. And those are things that were never really considered when the control center was built in the first place. So we've had to come up with some innovative ideas and ways to allow them to do that, but still have it be safe so that we can't compromise the space station.
So that the commanding and the other things that are built, that it was built to do, will still do.
Right.
Yeah. We've referred to the fact over the years that this room is in the same building as the space shuttle flight control room, and you pointed out that, of course, that's not used for space shuttle commanding anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Talk more about what it is being used for right now. What have your folks had to do in that room to get it ready for its next act?
Well, actually, the Orion Exploration Flight Test 1, which is scheduled for 14, is planning to use a lot of the same equipment that we have in here today. So there's not a whole lot of extra effort that we had to do to make it capable of supporting that flight.
That's it.
Mm-hmm. And so that test is actually going to use the same workstations that we have installed. Our workstations are very flexible. We try to make sure that everything that we do is something that we can use in the future. So our workstations can be loaded with whatever operating system we need. And so it's going to sit there and be used for tests and observations for that mission until then. We also use it to support some of the other activities we have going on in the building.
such as training of flight controllers?
Training and tests that we do with collaboration with some of the other centers and international partners. We support all those kind of activities in this building daily, and so we're always looking for extra seats because this room obviously is used full-time for ISS. So.
And occasionally the folks in here do get moved to other rooms. Are the other control rooms capable of commanding the space station? Can people work in there?
Yes, you are able to send a command to the space station from any workstation in this building. That was one of the foundations that we had when we designed the new building back in the 90s, was that we wanted the concept of a roving flight controller, which means that we can put our flight control team anywhere within this building and they can get the same tools and have the same capabilities that they would in this room.
Your group is responsible for all of the control rooms and everything in this building, as well as another building that is elsewhere at JSC, the Jake Garn Simulator and Training Facility, Building 5. What sorts of things are you folks supporting over there?
Yeah, that's right. A couple of years ago, we found some efficiencies in combining the operations of this facility and the training facility. And so our main capability over there right now is the space station training facility, where we have a mock-up of the modules of the space station, and all of them are functional. We have computer models in there that aren't exactly what you have on board, but are close enough that we can train our flight controllers and our astronauts to identify and troubleshoot problems. It also allows them to go through their standard procedures and get adept at that as well. And the other thing that we have coming into Building 5 is that we're constantly looking forward. We're trying to find the next innovative way to make what we do here more cost effective. And we have a project called Training Systems 21, TS-21, and they are looking at ways to have that capability not only for the space station, but also for any other visiting vehicles that we would have. And so we have a lot of work going on in that facility, building up for that future implementation out in 2015.
Yeah, I assume that you've also been involved with the changeover, because there were a lot of space shuttle training facilities that were in that building until recently, too.
That's right. We call that shuttle transition and retirement, so shuttle TNR, because we have to make everything an acronym here. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of work going on in that building. The building at one time housed our motion base, which is the simulator that actually moves and allows the flight controllers or allows the astronauts to get their training in how to control the spacecraft. And we also had a fixed base that was stationary that allowed them to go and work through their procedures. And so both of those are currently being dismantled and prepared for shipment.
It's building up new, taking down old all at the same time.
That's right.
Tell me about how you came into this job. Have you been working NASA long or in facilities management?
Well, actually, I came to NASA in the year 2000, so I came from the petrochemical industry. So that's not a standard career path that most people take. A lot of people come straight out of college. But so I came here in 2000, and I went into flight control. I was a shuttle electrical power systems flight controller. And then in 2003, I was given the opportunity to move over to the facilities division, which handles all of the infrastructure that you see here. And I was actually the project manager for the last update that we did to all of the workstations. And so I've been in facilities since 2003.
Did you enjoy being a flight controller?
You know, it has its moments. My husband is also a flight controller, and at home we say that flight control is hours of sheer boredom followed by moments of sheer terror. Mm-hmm. So there were some very exciting times when I was a flight controller where we had to do troubleshooting on the station that I'll never forget.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah, things that specifically you'd never trained for, but that's the job.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Coming out of the petrochemical industry, what was your education background? What education gets you ready for that job and this one too?
Well, I'm actually a mechanical engineer. So I did mechanical engineering when I was in petrochem. And when I came here, I switched over to electrical. And then I've been doing computers ever since. So I think for flight control, really the important thing is that you have a degree in science and math. So it doesn't matter what your degree is. My fellow coworkers had physics degrees, math degrees, all of the engineering degrees. So it really just matters that you're into science and you're a critical thinker.
And do you have the excitement of space flight, being in charge of keeping the building running?
It's very exciting. You would think that you'd be a bit removed since we're not always sitting in this room, except that within our group, we do actually have the ground controllers who sit in this room, in the back of the room, and they control all of the ground assets, all of the communication gear, and they make sure that everything is working. And so not only do we have their involvement and their excitement, but also we have to work around the mission whenever we're making changes in the facility. So we're constantly aware of what's going on orbit to make sure that we don't do anything that could compromise any sort of critical phase.
I know I appreciate the fact that all this stuff works, and everyone else does too. Thank you. Angela Bauer is the lead of the Facility Operations and Maintenance Group in the Mission Operation Directorate here at the Johnson Space Center.